Hello again, hockey fans, and welcome to part 2 of our look at the illustrious career of Lanny McDonald, the hard-working, gritty, and highly talented right-winger, and when we had last left you, he had been a victim of a trade out of spite from the Toronto Maple Leafs. For more details on that, check out part 1 if you haven't already. We left off at the end of the 1979-80 season, where he finished as a member of the Colorado Rockies, the worst team in the NHL perennially since their existence. Going into the 1980-81 season, Lanny at least had time to settle into life in Denver, even if it wasn't the place he necessarily wanted to be. But it was nothing against his teammates or the team itself, really. He has stated on several occasions that he loved those guys in Denver, who always worked hard even if they weren't the best team in the league. The team must have reeked from afar, however, because even Sam Pollock, the legendary GM of the Montreal Canadiens, had the foresight to see this team would still suck come the 1980s. And got their first round draft pick that year. First overall, I might add. Don Cherry was fired at the end of the 1979-80 season as head coach, yet Ray Miron still had a job. Ugh. Anyway, they hired Bill McMillan, who at the age of 37 was considered young for a head coach, but he was coming off of being an assistant for the coach to the Stanley Cup champion New York Islanders, where he was a fan favorite player during his career. Going to the 11th game of the year, the Rockies were pretty good 4-4-2, and Lanny had 8 points, not bad at all. But in this 11th game, however, was huge. It was Lanny's first game back in Toronto since the trade. There was a media frenzy around Lanny and his homecoming, and as luck would have it, the game aired on a Saturday night, November 1st, 1980, on a program that Lanny had been heavily featured on throughout his career, Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. The Leafs were off to a good start themselves, 6-3-1. Lanny got an immense reception from the Leaf fans he cherished throughout his time in Toronto. Signs lovingly adoring his name were spread throughout the crowd. The game was underway. And early on, Daryl Sittler, who was off to a hot start that year, opened the scoring for the Leafs and the game. 41 seconds later, Boreas Salming scored its 2-0 Leafs. But just over a minute after that, Joel Quenneville, part of the big trade, sets up another former Leaf, Walt McKechnie, to put the Rockies on the board. Later on, Ivan Vucher scored on a goal assisted by another former Leaf, Trevor Johansson. It's tied 2-2 after the first. In the second period, Lanny begins a play that leads to a pass to McKechnie, and it ends on a goal from 18-year-old rookie Paul Gagne. The Rockies take the lead. Lanny gets a rousing response from the Leafs faithful for the assist. And aw, poor Pal Hal had to endure the return of Dave Keon and the Whalers being the Leafs last season, and now this. The Rockies took a 4-2 lead, and while Lanny had many chances at some goals, he wasn't able to find the net, but regardless, they looked to be in control. But Sittler scored later in the period, and the Rockies led 4-3 after 2. Randy Pierce scored near the midway mark of the third period to put the Rockies up 5-3, at least got one back from Bill Dorlago. And the Rockies hang on, however, for a 5-4 win. Yeah, come on, Lanny, rub it in the face of Ballard and Imlach, and make it known how you're still awesome. Well, luckily for the two grumpy old men, Lanny was too classy for that, and just simply saw it as a win for his team. The parties of the trade all played well, as both Lanny and Quenneville had an assist and a plus one, as did Pat Hickey of the Leafs. Wolf Paimon had 2 assists, and was also, however, a minus 2. Lanny carried that momentum into his next game with a 3-point effort against the Red Wings. Lanny stayed consistent throughout the season, but the Rockies were going nowhere fast. And after trading Rennie Robert to Toronto, I might add, Lanny was named team captain. And despite the city not having a huge, large hockey fan contingent, Lanny was very popular among the fans in attendance, and he had another 3-point night in the new year against the Minnesota North Stars. But going into the game against the Pittsburgh Penguins, the Rockies, despite being 12 games below 500, were in playoff contention, even with a 16-28-8 record. They were at home against the Pittsburgh Penguins, another team fighting to stay in playoff contention. Just over 5 minutes in, Lanny scores his 23rd goal of the year. The Pens eventually take a 2-1 lead, however, but the Rockies on the power play, Lanny helped an assist on a Lucien Deblois goal to make it 2-2 after the first period. Early in the second period, Lanny scored a goal, his second of the game, and the Rockies lead 3-2. Former Leaf Errol Thompson ties it for the Pens, and then they take a 4-3 lead shortly after, while Paul Gillis scored to make it 4-4, and Lanny has an assist and has another 4-point night, tying a career best he's achieved more than once. The Rockies got another, and the lead 5-4, but with 41 seconds left to play and an extra attacker, Lanny gets a hat-trick with an empty netter, a career best 5-point night. And yes, while Lanny has had 2 5-point games in the playoffs, this is actually his first of the regular season. Sadly, however, after this point, the Rockies went 5-17-5 to end the season and again missed the playoffs and were the third worst team in the league, despite setting a franchise record in wins with 22. Yay! It wasn't a bad year for Lanny. He had 35 goals and 46 assists for 81 points. Though both Rennie Robert as well as Mike McEwen were traded, the men he clicked with so well the year prior, this year it was his former teammate Walt McKechnie was the biggest helper, assisting on 9 of 35 of Lanny's goals. But his biggest contribution was to that of rookie Paul Gagne. Lanny assisted on 10 of his 25 goals and collaborated on assists with defenseman Rob Ramage, who had a breakout year with 8. Lanny's stats were enough for him to lead the team in scoring, once again averaging a point a game. But a string of 40-goal seasons comes to an end. He was named team captain, however, helped his team win in his return to Toronto. Sadly, was an awful minus 27, but again, on this team, that's not overly shocking. And missed the playoffs for the second straight year. He also represented Team Canada in the 1981 World Ice Hockey Championships. He scored 3 goals in that tournament, but Canada would finish 4th. But his big highlight was actually being voted Athlete of the Year from Colorado sports writers across the state. Going into the 1981-82 season, the future was looking even bleaker in Denver. Yes, indeed, that was even possible, as the Rockies were likely not to even be in the same town by the following year. Ray Miron, however, was finished as general manager as Bill McMillan was promoted to GM because they had such a great year, I guess? And it, hey, well, hey, franchise record, 22 wins, hey, that's not so bad. Anyway, this season was off to an abysmal start, and Lanny did have a big 3-point night in another game in Toronto against his former team in a tie. Lanny scored the winning goal in a shocking upset over the Edmonton Oilers, and Gretzky, who had 212 points that season, was held pointless in that game. But Lanny suffered a wrist injury and would miss 5 games, all of which the Rockies would lose. Lanny would return on November 22nd in a tie over the Vancouver Canucks, and he was held off the score sheet. Then the next game, November 24th against the Calgary Flames, they were annihilated 9-2. Lanny did have an assist on one of those 2 goals, however. The Rockies were now winless in 7. Well, on November 25th, 1981, the Rockies flew to Winnipeg for the game against the Jets, but Lanny was told he was going back to Calgary. Indeed, on November 25th, 1981, Lanny McDonald was traded to the Calgary Flames, along with a 4th-round draft pick in 1983, in exchange for former All-Star Bob McMillan, and another former All-Star primarily with the Canucks back in the 1970s, Don Lever. The Flames, despite their domination of Colorado, were off to a pretty bad start as well, and both teams needed to make a big change. At first, Lanny was iffy on the trade. For one, despite the team woes, he'd gotten close with his teammates in Colorado. For another, he felt terrible, as if to say, the worst team in the league doesn't even want me anymore. But then he thought about it, and well, for one, another team did want him, and for another, he's pretty much going home, where he and his wife could both be happy and raise their family. Either way, Lanny's short stint in Colorado was over, and not a moment too soon, as the team was 3-14-4 at the time of the trade. He had 6 goals and 9 assists for 15 points in 16 games and was developing some chemistry with Brent Ashton, who assisted on 4 of his 6 goals. While 6 of Lanny's 9 assists were to Steve Tambellini, and 3 more, he actually collaborated with him as well. So Tambellini factored into all of Lanny's assists, pretty much. So Lanny McDonald was done with the Colorado Rockies after just parts of 3 seasons and only 1 full season. He only played 16 games with the Rockies this year and had 15 points in those games as he ends his time in Colorado. His time with the Colorado Rockies is more so remembered for what led him to arriving there, but he made the most of his time and again grew to be close with many of his teammates, and did accomplish winning Athlete of the Year in the state of Colorado in 1980. Despite it not being the highlight of his career, Lanny still proved he had value during his short stint with this lowly club, and did anything he could to make it work. Lanny had a lot to look forward to going to Calgary. The Flames were new to the area, having just spent 8 seasons in Atlanta as the Atlanta Flames. During their first year in the new city in 1980-81, they had done what they'd failed to do constantly over the years past. Make a deep playoff run, as they made a Cinderella run all the way to the semifinals before Minnesota eliminated them. However, before the trade, The team got off to a pretty bad start and were dealing with injury issues. They had the brilliant Cliff Fletcher as their general manager, who had been there since the beginning of their days in Atlanta. And coaching the team was Al McNeil, who had spent years in the Montreal Canadiens system to great success in the 1970s. The biggest thing affecting Calgary was the loss of their top scoring forward, Kent Nilsson, who'd be gone at least 2 months. The team still bolstered a strong lineup, however, with Guy Chouinard, Mel Bridgman, Jim Poplinski. On defense, you had Paul Reinhart and Pekka Ruotokallio. And in goal, the talented duo of Reggie Lemelin and Pat Riggin. Lanny made his debut for the Flames the day after the trade on November 26, 1981, and the fanfare was huge. The fans felt like one of their own was now representing the team. The media coverage was also immense to boot. Lanny was genuinely happy to be in Calgary. The Flames were 6-12-5 and were in 4th place in the Smythe division, barely ahead of the Rockies. It was a very important division game against the Los Angeles Kings. Lanny got a huge reception when he was introduced to the live crowd, and while he didn't score any goals, he was a +3 in a huge 7-1 win over the Kings. He was still finding his footing but playing well in his first few games in Calgary, but in early December, he went on a tear. A 4-point night in Vancouver, another one in a heated Battle of Alberta against the Oilers, where he had a hat trick to boot, and the Flames shocked their favored provincial rivals. Also, they were starting to win games more and more. They hit a losing skid later in the month, but they were at least motivated and would stay that way for the duration of the season. Those who said Lanny could never be the player he was in Toronto again were proven very wrong. He was that guy, and maybe even better once again, doing it on a team and a city that he loved. To put an emphatic statement on the year, however, in the second to last game of the season, Lanny scored a hat-trick and an assist for a 4-point night as the Flames destroyed his former team, the Colorado Rockies, 11-0. At this time, jerseys weren't as widespread as they are today. They were actually something you had to make special orders for, but Lanny's jersey still sold like hotcakes, and the fans were enthralled with their new hero. But even during his time in Toronto, Lanny was seen as a hero from Alberta-born hockey fans, so it's no surprise. He had 34 goals and 33 assists, 67 points in just 55 games with the Flames. Lanny was as great as he ever was. After the trade, the Flames went 23-22-12. They finished third in the Smythe division, just 2 points behind the Vancouver Canucks. That's who they were going to meet in the playoffs, as Lanny would make his first playoff appearance since 1979. It was an evenly matched series on paper. The Canucks had a talented core, but much like the Flames, weren't without their struggles. But they had talents such as Thomas Grodin, Stan Smyl, Ivan Boldarev, defenseman Harold Snips, amazing goaltender King Richard Brodeur, and Lanny's former leaving line mate, Tiger Williams. And they were also coached by Lanny's former coach in Toronto, Roger Neilson. The divisional format had a first-round best-of-five series now, and Game 1 took place in Vancouver. Stan Smyl scored 8 seconds in, setting a playoff record, while halfway through the period, the Canucks took a 2-0 lead. But a few minutes later, Mel Bridgman put the Flames on the board, and it was 2-1 Vancouver after 1. The second period was scoreless, but Vancouver went up 4-1 early in the third. The Flames didn't give up as Lanny assisted on a Willie play goal to bring them to within 2. And Bridgman scored again to close the gap to 4-3, but it was all for naught as the Canucks added another and won 5-3. Game 2, Pat Riggin and Richard Brodeur put on a show in net, and it was 1-1 at the end of regulation. A very exciting overtime ensued, and Lanny was one of the many players who had a chance to win it for the Flames. But it was Lanny's good friend Tiger Williams who'd win it for the Canucks. The Flames go back home empty-handed and try to avoid a sweep in Game 3, but it's all for naught. The Canucks down then 3-1 as Brodeur puts on a spectacle, stopping 42 shots, and the Canucks win their first playoff series in their 12-year history. Lanny wasn't much of a factor, but neither was the rest of the team, come to think of it, as they simply just ran into a hot goaltender and didn't have an answer for him. Lanny's first year in Calgary, however, seemed to put on a whole new motivation for him, as he formed great chemistry with linemate Guy Chouinard, who assisted on 10 of Lanny's 34 goals, and they collaborated on 6 assists. Also, Lanny gelled well with young Jim Poplinski and Kevin Laval, as they were developing a great on-ice rapport with just about anyone. Lanny's arrival in Calgary was a hit. Not only was he back in peak form, but he was quickly winning the hearts of fans all over the city. He averaged 1.2 points a game, was a +22, and became ingrained and popular in the community almost immediately. The big trade that sent Lanny McDonald to Colorado had a lot of circumstances and a few players involved. Well, Paymount was one of those players. He was the principal part of the trade with Lanny, but like Lanny in Colorado, would only play one season in Toronto in 1980-81. During the 81-82 season, he was traded to the Quebec Nordiques. Pat Hickey was traded that year as well, and Joel Quenneville was the only one who would stay with this team in this trade, who in 1982-83, the Rockies became known as the New Jersey Devils, and Quenneville went with them. Also to top it off, Daryl Sittler, Lanny's longtime close friend and teammate, the man who management wanted to spite by trading Lanny, was finally dealt after 12 seasons in 1982 to the Philadelphia Flyers. But when it comes to Lanny, the future looks bright in Calgary. Lanny's overall year saw him reach the 40-goal mark for the fifth time in his career and finish on the plus side of things and plus-minus stats for the first time since leaving Toronto. He makes his first playoff appearance since 1979, and he was back in peak form, as I said. But even his biggest fans had no idea what was about to come next season. Before the 1982-83 season was set to get underway, Al McNeil stepped down as head coach and stayed on with the Flames in their scouting department. Their new head coach was Badger Bob Johnson, who of course headed up the greatest college university hockey program arguably in all the world of professional hockey, the University of Wisconsin Badgers. Six WCHA championships, three NCAA national championships, not to mention a former coach of the U.S. national team at long last. He was in the pros. Many felt this was a long time coming. The Flames were looking to have something big this year as Kent Nilsson was healthy and Lanny was now the face of the team. Could they truly embark on a huge year? Well, the first three games of the season didn't seem so as they were 0-3-0. Lanny only had a goal and was a minus 3. Badger's coaching career was not a good start either. Now they had to face a powerful Edmonton Oilers and were down 1-0, barely 2 minutes into the game. They were struggling to get any momentum going, but then there was a power play where Kent Nilsson sent Lanny up for a goal to tie the game. However, sadly, the combo of Gretzky and Curry struck as they each assisted on each other's goals to take a 3-1 lead. But 34 seconds later, Captain Phil Russell scored, and 2 minutes later scored another, and the Flames had tied it. Nielsen gave the Flames their first lead with a power play marker in the second period, but Marc Messier scored an extra man netter as well, and we're tied 4-4. Richie Dunn restored the Flames' lead, and just under 2 minutes later, Lanny scores his second of the game on the power play. It's 6-4 Flames after two. It was 8-4 towards the end of the game in what was a scrappy Phil game full of penalties. The Alberta rivalry was really taking shape, but Lanny rubs salt into their open wound. A power play hat trick late in the game, only the 8th time in NHL history it had been done, and the Flames win 9-4. It's a huge first win of the season. This begins Lanny's 7-game point streak where he scores a huge 16 points. Now, November 1st, 1982, New Jersey Lanny scores another hat trick, this one the complete opposite, a natural hat trick. Then he continues to stay consistent after that, but then on December 10th, a game in Winnipeg, another hat trick, his third of the year. A Boxing Day game against the Oilers again, yes, you guessed it, his fourth hat trick of the year in a 4-4 tie with their rivals. Lanny just keeps rolling and rolling, and then on February 5th, another hat trick. 5 hat tricks on the year in a 7-4 win. His icon status in Calgary was growing before the very eyes of the fans. He was getting several endorsement deals, including one for, yep, McDonald's. Lanny was a bona fide megastar in their eyes, and rightfully so. And going into the All-Star game in 1983, where Lanny was selected to play, he was leading the league in goals with 47. Yes, even ahead of you-know-who by 3 goals. In the All-Star game, which was Lanny's third of his career and the first since 1978, he had a goal and an assist, but it was back to business in Calgary. The Flames, however, were not consistent as a whole as a team. Despite their plethora of talent, the team was 23-25-8 at the All-Star break, which was still good enough for second place, 5 points ahead of the Jets at the time. And at this point, Lanny had already tied his career high in goals in a season, but there's something more important to him than that, and that was being a champion. Stanley Cup ring meant more to Lanny than anything, and he wanted it badly no matter where he played, and that was his biggest goal come year in and year out despite some playoff woes. Lanny still stayed hot in the remaining 24 games. He reached the coveted 50-goal mark just 4 games after the All-Star break in a game against the Sabres. He also had a big 4-point night against the Canucks on the 1st of March, had 6 more 2-goal games, and the Flames, despite finishing with a losing record 2 games below 500, still finished in second place in the Smythe division, holding out the Vancouver Canucks, who went on a hot streak at the end of the season. But Lanny had a career year. 66 goals. Yes, he scored as many goals in one season as he did during his entire time with the Rockies. Lanny added 32 assists for a career-high 98 points. He finished 12th in league scoring, but Gretzky would win on to win the scoring race, and Lanny would finish second in goals. But hey, there's no shame in that. Look at this top five list. Mike Bossy, Michel Goulet, Marcel Dion, and of course Gretzky. Some of the greatest goal scorers of their time, and Lanny was second place in that list to Gretzky of all people. Nothing to sneeze at. What a year. Lanny, at the age of 30, was in peak form. He was also awarded the Molson Cup, which each Canadian team hands out every year to the player with the most points in three-star selections, which are chosen at the end of each game. Lanny was a runner-up for the award last season in Calgary, as well as three times in Toronto. He also won the Bill Masterton Trophy at the NHL Awards. For those who don't know, it's awarded to the player yearly who exemplifies the qualities of perseverance, sportsmanship, and dedication to the game of hockey. Translation, Lanny in a nutshell. Arguably the most dedicated player of all time. Also, Lanny was selected as a second-team All-Star for the second time in his career, and the first time since 1977. But now it was time to focus on the playoffs. And in Calgary's way was the team that swept them out last year, the Vancouver Canucks. Game 1 was a roller coaster ride, as the Flames led 1-0 in the second period. The Canucks roared back with two goals and took a 3-1 lead in the third as well. But then Phil Russell brought the Flames back to within one, and midway through the frame, Lanny sets up Poplinski to tie the game and we're off to overtime. Each fan in the Settle Dome is eager to see what happens, and Eddie Beer scores the winner as the Flames take game one. Game two is once again sees the Flames down, this time 1-0 in the second. But on the power play, Lilson to Lanny, he scores, the game is tied. The Flames score another and lead 2-1 after two periods. Lanny then scores his second of the game, almost 4 minutes into the third, and the Flames run away with it and maintain control. They take both games at home, this one by a score of 5-3. The series shifts to Vancouver as the Flames attempt a sweep. And after a scoreless first period, the Flames find themselves stunned, down 3-0 in the second period. Nilsson scores over to put them on the board, but Rick Lands restores the Canucks' 3-goal lead, and just over a minute later, Kevin Laval scores. However, the Canucks still lead 4-2 going into the third. The Flames roar back with goals by Richie Dunn and Mel Bridgman, and the game is tied. But with 57 seconds left, Stan Schmeel scores, and the Canucks hang on to win 5-4. The series isn't over yet. It's another big back-and-forth game for Game 4, still in Vancouver. But it was 2-1 Vancouver, then 3-2 Calgary. All they had to do was hang on in the third, but with 2:22 remaining, Garth Butcher ties it and we're off to overtime again. It just takes a minute and 6 seconds after as Greg Meredith of the Flames scores and they're moving on to the second round. Lanny played very well in Game 2, but was relatively quiet throughout most of the series, but regardless was still a key factor in the win. But now standing in their way, the Edmonton Oilers. Indeed, this would be the first playoff edition of the Battle of Alberta. The Flames, however, were not intimidated, as they had played pretty well against the Oilers all year. And yes, the cast is all there. Gretzky, Curry, Messier, Anderson, Linsman, Coffey, Lowe, Huddy, Fuhr, Moog. And Lanny himself plays quite well against the Oilers historically to boot. Game 1 is, of course, all set from Edmonton, and it's heated from the get-go. The game would see a total of 52 penalty minutes combined from both teams, but the Flames can't get much going. It's not that they're bad as so much as the Oilers are just plain damn good and destined to be champions. Gretzky's actually held pointless, but Messier had 4 goals, and they lead 6-1 in the third period. The Flames got 2 back, but that was as good as it would get, a 6-3 final for the Oilers. Game 2 is even more intense, 70 penalty minutes, but the Flames, again, perform no better, and they lose 5-1 as Andy Moog is hot in net to boot. And even worse, Lanny is hurt and will miss the next game. The team, however, gets a hero's welcome in Calgary, but they are utterly humiliated 10-2 in a game that saw 102 penalty minutes, including a bench brawl. Wayne Gretzky also set an NHL record for points in a playoff game with 7. Lanny is back, however, for Game 4, and he is not a quitter, and neither are the Flames, as they do not roll over and die. They play their hearts out. Lanny is a warrior out there, and an amazing performance, a goal and 2 assists for a 3-point night. The Flames had a 5-1 lead in the third period. They almost let it slip, but held on to win 5-4. And now we go back to Edmonton for Game 5. But despite that amazing performance and warrior heart effort, the Flames are walloped again, this time 9-1, as the Oilers take the series. At the end of the day, the Oilers were just too good and just too dominant. But Lanny's performance in Game 4 was a great moment for Flames fans and really proved his dedication to the game and just why he won the Masterton Trophy, because he refused to give up and refused to allow his team to just roll over, down 3-0. He still had his eyes on getting that Stanley Cup. Even if he didn't get there in the end, he was probably hungry for it even more. Lanny's career year in his monster 66 goals, so most of them assisted by Guy Chouinard, who had 24 assists on them total. That's more than a third of Lanny's goals. And while Lanny didn't have many assists that year compared to years prior, he did have chemistry with Chouinard in that aspect as well. He also had great chemistry with another star forward of the Flames, Kent Nielsen, as he assisted on 7 goals for both men. He also collaborated on 8 assists with Chouinard, as this top Calgary line was a force to be reckoned with, like it could be for years to come. This is indeed Lanny's career year. His 66 goals are second in the league. His 98 points are 12th in the league. Career high on both marks. Tied for 6th in power play goals. He tied teammate Kent Nielsen in the league for most hat tricks with 5. He won the Masters Trophy. He won the Molson Cup. He actually, for the first time in his career, had votes for the Hart Trophy coming in 8th. He was a second team All-Star for the second time. Played in his 3rd NHL All-Star game. It goes on and on and on. Endorsements. Memorable playoff performance in Game 3 of the Smythe Final. An amazing year for this amazing man. And this truly captures his spirit for the game of hockey. Now with 10 seasons under his belt, Lanny has accomplished a great deal, and while he's coming off a career year, his quest to be champion is what continues to drive him. A unique stat to bring up is that Lanny's teams have appeared in the playoffs 8 of his 10 seasons, and 7 of those times they were eliminated by either the eventual Stanley Cup champions or a Stanley Cup finalist. Seems to be no matter how good the teams are that Lanny plays for, they run into someone better, the cream of the crop of the league, as well as the Vancouver Canucks. But nonetheless, this still reigns true. Also, some changes going into the new season. Guy Chouinard was traded in the offseason for the Flames, but they add a huge addition to the team, that being a rookie defenseman by the name of Al MacInnis. Also, Captain Phil Russell departed the team, so they needed a captain, and of course Lanny was a big candidate, as he and fellow veteran Doug Risebrough shared the co-captaincy for the Flames. Lanny starts out the year right. In just the 3rd game of the year, he has a 4-point night, but the Flames drop a loss to the Minnesota North Stars. Lanny wasn't having the insane season he had the year before, but was still delivering at a great pace, to very little surprise. He had another 3-point night and a win over the LA Kings on November 26th. Lanny was struggling, however, in certain games, but overall was still playing at a high level and was selected to the NHL All-Star game for the 4th time in his career. When the All-Star break was over, Lanny went right back to work with another 3-point night with a win over the New York Rangers. Then on February 16th, in a home win over Pittsburgh, Lanny had his first hat trick of the year and a 4-point night, not to mention it was the 3rd win in a row for the Flames. However, during the next game, a tie against the high-powered Boston Bruins, Lanny was injured and suffering from lingering muscle injuries. The Flames were 25-21-12 at this point. Lanny would miss the next 15 games, a month of action. They still stayed consistent somewhat, going 7-7-1 in Lanny's absence. At this point, he had 60 points in 58 games. He returned on March 20th, and the Flames beat the Whalers and had now won 3 straight at that point. Lanny obtained his second hat-trick of the year the very next game against the Detroit Red Wings. The Flames would have lose that game, and their streak was halted. Despite that great performance, Lanny struggled immensely to end the season, and was even a -6 in a loss to Edmonton. Either way, the Flames had a lot to be happy about, as they were once again in second place in the Smythe Division, were headed to the playoffs, and finished with a winning record of 34-32-14. Lanny had 33 goals and 33 assists for 66 points in 65 games, a good season despite fighting injuries most of the year. Lanny was apparently playing hurt a lot of that time as well. In the opening round for the 3rd straight season, the Vancouver Canucks, who stood in their way, each team having won a series against the other. Game 1 is in Calgary, and the fans are rabid. The Flames are looking like what their name entails, and Reggie Lemelin is fantastic and en route to a 5-3 Flames victory. Game 2, Lemelin is still playing amazing, but so is Richard Brodeur of the Canucks, but the Flames pull another one out and take a 2-game series lead with a 4-2 win this time. Game 3 in Vancouver, the Flames go for the sweep, but the Canucks are ferocious on this night. The Canucks decimate Lemelin to the point where he is pulled. Doug Hallward's hat trick and a young rookie by the name of Cam Neely power the Canucks to a 7-0 throttling. Game 4, however, Paul Reinhart responds with a hat trick of his own. The Flames dominate the Canucks, taking Game 4 5-1 in this series 3-1. You may notice I didn't mention Lanny's name. That's because he was held off the score sheet for the entire series. But on the plus side, and well, quite literally, he was actually a +2. So now waiting them in the second round? The Edmonton Oilers. A team that had one of the best regular seasons in NHL history with 57 wins and 119 points. The Flames don't have a snowball chance in hell. Pardon the sort of pun there. Lenny will need to play much better in this series if they want to have any kind of a fight. Part 2 of the Battle of Alberta started with Game 1 in Edmonton, and then with the Flames down 3-1, Lanny struck on the power play and closed the gap to within a goal. The Oilers, however, held them off and notched two more in a 5-2 win. In Game 2, the Flames came out ready to play, however. Just under 2 minutes in, Dan Quinn scored and the Flames struck first. The Oilers would tie it late in the period, however, and it was 1-1 after one. But it looked like the same song and dance in the second period. The Oilers struck with 3 goals to lead 4-1. The Flames did get one back, but trailed 4-2 after two. Early in the third period, Richard Crom made a great individual effort, and the Flames were within one, and then later on, Lenny sets up Kerry Wilson. The game is tied. A huge comeback for the Flames. And with 1:33 to go, Steve Bozak scores. And here we go. The Flames lead 5-4, but the Oilers won't go away quietly as number 99 scored with 45 seconds to play, and we're off to overtime. And 3:42 in, Lanny McInnes, capped off by Wilson. He scores. The Flames stun the Oilers with a 6-5 win on their home ice. The series is tied, headed to Calgary. The Flames fans are psyched after what happened in Game 2. The first period, however, was scoreless, but early in the second, Reinhardt scores and the building erupts. However, 30 seconds later, Paul Coffey silences the crowd near the midway point, and it also scores another to make it 2-1 for the Oilers. They make it 3-1 early in the third, but 2.5 minutes later, Lanny wakes up the crowd as the Flames close the gap to a goal, while the Oilers hold them off and regain control of the series with a 3-2 win. Game 4, however, the fans haven't lost their faith, as Edmonton is still leading, however, 2-0 in the second period, but Eddie Beer has put some on the board, and Lanny is in on a Paul Reinhardt goal. The game is tied, but 44 seconds later, Yari Kurri scores. The Oilers lead 3-2 after 2. Literally just 9 seconds into the third period, Messier scores. It's 4-2 Edmonton, but just over 2.5 minutes later, Lanny strikes. The Flames are still in it, but the Oilers ice it with an empty netter. The Flames find themselves on the verge of elimination, going back to Edmonton. Ah, Calgary, it's been great, but it's all over with the crying. Game 5, emotions are running high as the penalties were aplenty, but what's this? Jamie McCowan scores. The Flames strike first, but the Oilers do tie it later on. But just over 2 minutes apart, Lanny sets up Dan Quinn, and Pawlinski scores as well. 3-1 Calgary after one? Well, we all know the Oilers will come back, but hey, Lanny scores. It's 4-1. Oh, but there's a goal by Glenn Anderson, and oh, but Mikey scores. It's a 3-goal lead for the Flames, but the lead is cut off again, and it's 5-3 Calgary going into the third. The Oilers press and press, and they do get a goal, and the fans are really rabid at the Northlands Coliseum, but Lemelin is amazing in net. The Flames hang on, and they're still alive. Lanny is playing incredible hockey to boot. And the rejuvenation of this Flames team is something to behold, and the fans are psyched for Game 6. It's still do or die, and the Flames strike first, and yes, it's Lanny on the power play. Oh, baby. It goes back and forth. The Oilers tie it. Pawlinski gives the Flames a lead, but it ends 2-2 after one. Same thing in the second. Quinn scores. Samenko ties it, but Reinhardt scores. It's 4-3 Flames after two. Both teams try with all their might in the third, but only Messier scores, and the Flames have no answer. It's 4-4 after the buzzer. We're going to overtime. But just over a minute in, it happened. And sadly, I couldn't find that damn clip to post here. But Lanny is the hero. His first playoff OT winner since the infamous OT goal in 1978 for the Leafs to eliminate the Islanders. And this one is also oh so very important and etched in the memories of Flame fans who were around at that time. It's a huge 3-point night for Lanny, and he's the hero once again. We're off to Game 7. The Flames are on the verge of doing the impossible, but the Oilers take a 2-0 lead midway through the first, with both goals just 20 seconds apart. The Flames roar back to tie it 2-2 after one. Kurri puts the Oilers back up just over a minute into the second, but Lanny sets up Conroy. We're tied again, then Al McInnes scores. The Flames lead 4-3. But Anderson and Lindsman score just under a minute apart to take a 5-4 lead, and Yari Kurri later makes it 6-4. Sadly, the Flames just run out of gas, and the Oilers add one more in the third to take the win 7-4 and take the series in 7 games. Lanny didn't even have a shot on goal despite his assist. As with the ongoing trend I just mentioned earlier, the Oilers went on to win the Cup. Lanny, however, was incredible in this series. 6 goals, 7 assists, 13 points in 7 games. A great showing by Lanny and the Flames. As a matter of fact, Lanny tied, you guessed it, Gretzky for the series scoring lead as both had 13 points. Lanny brought his A-game, but the Oilers were just slightly better in the end. Lanny's 33 goals this year were mainly assisted by top rookie prospect Dan Quinn, who Lanny worked a lot with and took under his wing. Quinn assisted on 13 of them. That's more than a third. The two collaborated on 7 assists together as well, while Lanny assisted on 8 Eddie Beers goals, as Beers had a banner year in his own right. Lanny missed 15 games, meaning 66 points came in 65 games. He was a minus 15, sadly, and did have a few struggles here and there, but was still consistent for the most part. He played in his fourth NHL All-Star game. His amazing 13-point performance in the playoff series against Edmonton was something to behold, and showed his will to fight to try and be a champion. Lanny spent much of the offseason dealing with several muscle-related injuries, and it was looking bleak going into the 1984-85 season that he'd be ready in time for opening night. He actually would miss the first 3 games of the season, but returned in a game against the Winnipeg Jets, which the Flames won 7-4. But Lanny came back way too soon and was out right after that outing, which saw him go scoreless. Lanny then missed the next 19 games and came back on December 1st, as the Flames were off to a tremendous start that year. He could definitely enhance that. He scored a goal in his return in a win over the Minnesota North Stars, but he was having trouble finding his groove, but did score 2 goals against the Penguins a week later, one of the few times he'd score off against Mario Lemieux. Lanny was hit or miss in some games, as it was clear his injuries were really starting to mount, but his spirit and will to win kept him going, as he had a 3-point night against Montreal on February 5th, and 11 days later, a 4-point night against the Jets. He was on a roll in February, 15 points, 11 games. Unfortunately, in a March 9th game against the Quebec Nordiques, Lanny was hurt again, and he'd missed the rest of the regular season. He played just 43 games and had 19 goals and 18 assists for 37 points. For the first time since 1979-80, he failed to average a point a game. And for only the fourth time in his 12-year career, he failed to hit that mark as well. It's a shame because the Flames had one of their best regular seasons ever, 41-27-12 for 94 points. As great as that was, it was only good enough for third in the Smythe Division, as the Winnipeg Jets had a huge year that year, finishing with 96 points, meaning these two teams would meet in the first round. They had to move on without him. Game 1 at the Peg, the Flames had a 4-1 lead but completely fell apart as the Jets came back to tie it and won it in overtime on a Brian Mullen goal. Things got no better in Game 2 as the Jets dominate the Flames with a 5-2 win as the Jets could go for a sweep on Calgary's ice. However, our hero at last returned and the Flames seemed a lot more motivated in Game 3. A huge night from Håkan Lube, a 33-save shutout from Reggie Lemelin. The Flames are still in it, but Lanny is not. He is out the next game and the Flames are eliminated, losing 5-3. Lanny just played 1 game and saw very little ice time in that game as well. It was clear he wasn't fully healed up. However, this would only be the second time in his career his team would not lose to an eventual cup finalist and or champion. Lanny's scoring that year was, to no surprise, the second lowest of his career, but what he did produce was an effective chemistry with an offensive-minded defenseman, which was no stranger to him in his career, as Al MacInnis assists on 8 of 19 of Lanny's goals. His chemistry with Dan Quinn also continues, as Quinn was emerging as one of the top forwards on the team. It's probably not a year Lanny wants to remember, missing 37 games and playing in just 43, but we give him kudos for trying to constantly fight through those injuries, which had obviously been lingering for quite some time. Now with 12 NHL seasons played, and only at 31 years old, Lanny's clock was suddenly ticking faster. Well, even if it was, Lanny wasn't going to let this defeat him. So now going into the 1985-86 season, the Flames were looking better and better, but Lanny had a goal, and that was to stay healthy for the duration of the season and help guide the Flames to a championship team. They had the right coach, fantastic young players, though they did part with Kent Nilsson. They have their eyes on the biggest prize, something Lanny had dreamed about since he was a child, hoisting that Stanley Cup. The Flames' defense was progressing into one of the best cores in the league, and now with the addition of rookie Gary Suter to boot, it looked even better. Lanny and the Flames started the season right with a win over the Winnipeg Jets, where Lanny had a goal and 3 assists for a 4-point night. He was looking sharp. He was working harder than ever to help this team attain a given win. The Flames went on a hot streak in November, going into December winning 7 of 8 games. In one of those games, a win against the New York Rangers, Lanny had 2 goals and assists for a 3-point night. As of December 12, 1985, the Flames were 17-8-3 for 37 points, second place behind the powerful Oilers. Lanny had 25 points in those 28 games, but then something happened. The Flames plummeted. The Flames lost 11 in a row. There were even rumors going out Bob Johnson would be fired. But the players, much like they respected Lanny, respected their coach, and they all kept their faith in each other. Lanny was one of the few players actually staying consistent down that stretch, as he still obtained 8 points in those 11 losses. Lanny took his role as a leader very seriously and refused to let this team just keep on plummeting. They broke their losing streak with a win over the Canucks, but after losing to Philly, they went unbeaten in 6 of their next 7 games. It seemed things were back on track, one of which Lanny had a 2-goal/3-point night in Detroit during that stretch as well. Meanwhile, during this time, the Flames made a huge acquisition. They acquired Joe Mullen, a 2-time 40-goal scorer who had spent the last 5 seasons with the St. Louis Blues and was one of their most consistent forwards. In Mullen's first 10 games with the team, they went 7-2-1, which led directly into a huge 5-game winning streak in March. Lanny had a huge night against Mario and the Penguins with 4 assists in that stretch as well. Going into the playoffs, they would need a little more experience, however. Playoff experience, that is. While Mullen has always been a top playoff performer with the Blues, the team never went beyond the second round. But now they needed Stanley Cup experience, and they got it with John Tonelli. Much like Lanny, Tonelli had a hard work ethic and a scoring touch to boot. He was a former All-Star, a great clutch player who had played a great defensive game to boot. He had spent 8 seasons with the New York Islanders and collected 4 Stanley Cup rings and was a key part of those teams. The Flames got him at the trade deadline. They finished the season strong as well with a 3-game winning streak, including a shocking 9-3 win at home against the Oilers, who at this point were more powerful than ever. The Flames finished 40-31-9 for 89 points, finishing second again in the Smythe Division. Lanny played all 80 games that season, the first time he's done that since his huge 1982-83 season, and finished with 28 goals and 43 assists for 71 points, second in team scoring just a point behind line mate Dan Quinn. First up in the opening round, the team that eliminated them the year before, the Winnipeg Jets, although the Jets had an awful year and barely slipped into the playoffs. They did a 180 from their year the year prior, which was a huge year in their history. Despite bolstering stars like Dale Howard, Chuck, Paul McLean, Thomas Steen, and Randy Carlyle, the team just had no real direction at this point. Calgary still took them seriously, however, as they remember what happened last year. However, Bob Johnson took a huge risk. Instead of going with veteran Reggie Lemelin, they went with rookie Mike Vernon. No rookie goaltender has been in a Stanley Cup winner since Ken Dryden in 1971 for the Montreal Canadiens. No chance. In Game 1, Calgary shot down the Jets, a huge team effort, which saw Lanny opening the scoring of these playoffs as the Flames easily take Game 1, 5-1. Game 2, the Jets put up more of a fight, but the Flames were still in control throughout the game, never leading them any less than 2 goals. Lanny is outstanding with 2 assists for a 3-point night as he added a goal in the 6-4 Flames win. They now head to Game 3 in Winnipeg and try to obtain a sweep. It's a rookie goaltending showdown between Daniel Bertholm and Mike Vernon. Both youngsters are brilliant, and the Flames do lead 2-0 in the first, but the Jets cut the deficit in half before the end of the first period. At period number 2, both goalies and the Flames defense are on top of things. The third period, the Jets score 2 more as they take their first lead of the series. But on the power play, with 1:43 to play, Alan MacInnis launches a shot and ties it, and we're up to overtime. So who's going to be the hero? You guessed right! 8:25 into the frame, Lanny scores his third career OT winner and second OT series winner of his career. It's the Flames avenge last year with a sweep and are off to the Smythe Division final. Lanny was nothing short of outstanding in this series. 5 points in 3 games, plus a series winner and a great performance in Game 2, and a boot was a +6. The Flames were looking incredible going into the second round, and they were going to have to, because awaiting them in the Smythe Division final, oh yes, the 2-time defending Stanley Cup champion, Edmonton Oilers, as part 3 of the Battle of Alberta was ready to commence. The Oilers were somehow even better in many ways at this point, as they were during their last showdown, which saw the Flames come to within a Game 7 of a huge upset. But much like that series, the Flames would not be intimidated and were ready for their rivals. And despite the rabid nature of the loud Northlands crowd, the Flames silenced them quick. Lanny did, that was, and the Flames struck first just a minute and a half in with his goal. Gary Suter added another, and the Flames were up 2-0 after 1. Rookie goalie Mike Vernon is sure to crumble under the pressure of this Oilers team, right? There's no way Calgary has a chance here, right? Well, Glenn Anderson does get one back, with little time remaining in the second, and cuts the Flames' lead in half. In the third period, however, Vernon is a wall. Mullen and Lou both score for the Flames. Shocking 4-1 win in Edmonton. The hockey world is buzzing a little bit in a game that saw nearly 100 combined penalty minutes. In Game 2, the Flames strike first again, but this time it's Lou with a solo shorthanded effort, but Anderson ties it 1-1 after one. Both teams trade goals in the second. It's 2-2, but Quinn and Mullen both score. Calgary leads 4-2 after two. What is going on here? Edmonton, however, tirelessly fights to tie it in the third period, and with just 3:14 left, Dave Hunter gives the Oilers their first lead of the series so far. But with 1:20 left, Joe Mullen comes through for the Flames. It's tied, and we're off to OT. However, Lanny is not the hero this time. It was Glenn Anderson, and the Oilers take Game 2 to tie the series and head to Calgary. Either way, there's many rumblings in the sports media that the Flames may have the Oilers' number this year. Game 3 is the most disciplined game of the series so far, with less scraps and fights and just 16 total penalty minutes. Reinhardt and Gretzky trade power play goals in the first period and is tied 1-1 after one, Lanny assisting on the Reinhardt goal. The Flames' defense has given the Oilers a tough time, as is John Tonelli. And the only goal of the second period comes off the stick of Colin Patterson. The Flames lead 2-1 after two. Just over a minute into the third, however, Glenn Anderson ties it for the Oilers, but defensive forward Joel Otto, who has been outstanding in the playoffs, scores to keep the Flames up, and Vernon, for the most part, does what he can to hang on to win 3-2 and take a 2-1 series lead. In Game 4, however, the Oilers make an emphatic statement, as late in the opening period, they take a 2-0 lead with goals 20 seconds apart from Gretzky and Craig McTavish. From that going forward, the Flames were playing catch-up the rest of the way. This was the opposite of the last game, with brawls and a fight, scraps aplenty, and just over 200 penalty minutes combined. And to top it off, Gretzky has a 5-point night. The Flames lose 7-4. Vernon is also pulled during the game. Going into Game 5, the fickle Canadian sports media is now saying that the Flames' luck has run out, that Vernon was exposed heavily in Game 4, and that Reggie Lemelin should get the start for the next big Game 5. But the Badger keeps his faith in Vernon, and in Game 5, in Edmonton, he would not regret his decision. Vernon and Fear, however, are both amazing in the first period. With under a minute to go in the frame, Quinn scores and the Flames carry a 1-0 lead into the second. Gretzky, however, tied it in the second frame, but Lanny strikes and the Flames have their lead back, and Vernon holds them in the rest of the way. Joel Otto adds a goal, and then in the third period, an empty netter from McCowan, the Flames stun the Oilers again on their home ice, and now have them on the verge of elimination, going back to Calgary. And the fans are ready for it as Game 6 moves to the Saddle Dome. The first period, neither team could strike, but early on in the second period, Mullen and Tonelli, the two big acquisitions respectively, scored back-to-back goals. 1:22 apart, the Flames lead 2-0. But Tikkanen and Messier tied, it's 2-2 after two. And the Oilers, however, sadly, would run away with it with three goals in the third for a 5-2 win, or off to Game 7. The Canadian sports media is divided. Many are saying that the fact that Calgary has gotten this far against this Oilers team with a rookie goalie speaks volumes of how this upset is very much possible. Others say the Oilers run it more together in Game 6 and still believe the Flames' luck will run out. Despite a penalty-filled and fight series, both teams would be best to stay disciplined in this situation. Just 18 overall penalty minutes would end up in Game 7. Both teams had tightened up defensively in this one, but Håkan Lube, like he's known to do, shocks the Oilers on the penalty kill with his second shorthanded goal of the playoffs. Late in the first period, the Oilers don't respond, and the Flames lead 1-0 after one. And just over 2 minutes into the second period, Lanny sets up Poplinski, 2-0 Flames, and fans still obviously remember, however, what happened in the last game. And the Oilers' main clutch man, Glenn Anderson, puts some on the board, and with 51 seconds to play in the period, Mark Messier ties it. It's 2-2 after two in the seventh game, going into the third period. And getting ready for some tension. Oh, here we go. Early in the third period, it's kind of a calm game. Perry Barrison, one of the Flames' grinding forwards, just casually shoots the puck into the Oilers' zone as Grant Fear leaves his puck in behind the net for rookie defenseman Steve Smith to take it out of the zone, and no. The problem was Smith made the worst rookie mistake at the worst time. His clear attempt bounced off of Fear and into the net. The Flames get a goal, and Barrison gets credit for it. The Flames lead 3-2. A huge, shocking turn of events, not at all what anyone expected. And Vernon is in there doing his job, as the Flames' defense is clinging on to this one-goal lead. But 35 seconds left, the Flames are called for too many men on the ice. With an empty net, the Oilers will surely come up in the clutch with six skaters on four. There's no way they're going to lose like this, right? Well, the Flames' defense does their job. 3-2-1, the Flames finally win the Battle of Alberta, one of the most stunning and storied upsets in playoff history. To this day, Steve Smith's gaffe is what's cited to give the Flames the big win. But we can't ignore the fact, and it shouldn't be ignored, that the Flames were excellent throughout the series and fought tooth and nail to win it. That should never be taken away from them. Lanny played well, with another 5-point performance and was a +2, and the Flames were off to the Campbell Conference Finals. They haven't made the third round since 1981. Well, for Lanny, this will be his first Stanley Cup semifinal series since 1978. His dream was inching closer to coming true. Awaiting them in the conference finals was another team that not many expected to be there either, the St. Louis Blues. The Blues, however, did have a very deep team in terms of talent. Playmaker Bernie Federko, a very young Doug Gilmore, and they were both having good playoff runs. A great leader in Brian Sutter. Lanny's former Rockies teammate, defenseman Rob Ramirez, and net, he had a pretty solid duo, Greg Millen and Rick Walmsley. Game 1 took place in Calgary as Flames fever was hotter than ever. Seriously, these puns are unintentional, I swear. Goaltenders Vernon and Walmsley were unbelievable in net, and the Flames did hold a 2-1 lead going into the latter part of the third period, but Mark Reed scored, as did Mark Hunter, just over a minute apart. And with 1:12 to go, the Flames went from hot to not. Oh, okay, that one was intentional. The Flames would drop Game 1 3-2. But the Flames didn't let that crush their spirit, and they responded immensely in Game 2, crushing the Blues with an 8-2 win. Lanny had a goal and a helper each, but the night belonged to Doug Risebrough, who had a hat trick, and Al MacInnis, who had a 4-point night. Now in St. Louis for Game 3, the Blues take a penalty just 8 seconds in, and 12 seconds later, Mullen makes them hay, but the Blues tie with a power play marker of their own. Again on the power play later in the period, Lanny scores, and the Flames lead 2-1 after 1. Tonelli gives the Flames a 2-goal lead while the Blues are trying to play catch-up. The Flames, however, lead 4-3 in the third. The Blues are pressing, but they can't do it. An empty netter and a 5-3 win and a 2-1 series lead. Game 4, however, this time it's the Blues who respond as Federko, along with veteran Rick Meager, not really known for a scoring touch at this time in his career, both had 3-point nights. Walmsley is great in net. It's a 5-2 win. The series is tied headed to Calgary. Game 5 is a scrapper with a combined 66 penalty minutes. Not the Battle of Alberta per se, but this team in the playoffs, emotions are bound to run high. The Flames, the one, however, who play the smart game and walk away with a 4-2 win. Their defense comes up big in this one. The Flames are just one win away from going to their first Stanley Cup, as is Lanny. Both Vernon and Walmsley, however, turned away everything in the first period of Game 6, and the Flames looked unstoppable when the second commenced. A power play goal by Quinn, 20 seconds in. Another power play goal from Quinn just over a minute and a half later. Out of nowhere, the Flames were up 2-0. It would actually lead 4-1 after two periods. Doug Wickenheiser scored for the Blues to cut the gap to 2 goals, but just over a minute later, Joe Mullen scores his 5-2 Flames with just under 13 minutes left in regulation time. All they gotta do is just hang on to this big lead. But a minute later, the Blues captain Brian Sutter scores, but the Flames are hanging on with 4:11 left, and Craig Peslowski scores, and the Blues are down by a goal all of a sudden. The Flames are also close to getting the cup, but with 1:08 left, Peslowski strikes again. We're off to overtime. This can't be happening. It's 7:30 into the extra frame. Doug Wickenheiser scores again in what has been dubbed the Monday Night Miracle, and it has been complete. We're off to a 7th and deciding game. Flames fans are a little weary. Going into Game 7, the criticism of the Flames is quite hefty after what happened in Game 6. They let a 3-goal lead slip with under 13 minutes to play and still had the lead with just over a minute to go and would lose. Game 7, however, the Calgary fans still believe in their team for the majority, and so do the Flames themselves, and it's once again the Flames' defense that comes through huge. They're not letting the Blues get any chances, and when they do, Vernon stops them. MacInnis scored early in the first, Patterson scored early in the second. The Flames led 2-0 after 2. And again, it's down to the final stretch. The clock is counting down, but Eddie Beers, who now plays for the St. Louis Blues, strikes his former team down with just 1:58 to play. But you can almost hear a pin drop in the Saddle Dome. It's 2-1 Calgary. But the time winds down. The Blues try with all their might, but 3, 2, 1, the Flames win. They are going to the Cup. Oh yes, Lanny was still playing in top form with 4 goals and an assist in the series. He had 5 points in each of the 3 series so far, had 15 points in the playoffs. And to top it off, he was at last in the Stanley Cup Finals. The goal he'd been working toward his whole career, hell, his whole life, was now right in front of him. So now the Flames, for the first time in their 14-year history, and Lanny for the first time in his 13-year career, had the chance to achieve the most glorious prize in the game, the Stanley Cup. As was the story with these 86 playoffs as a whole, awaiting them was a team that nobody expected to be in the finals either, the Montreal Canadiens. Yes, one of the rare times the Habs made the finals and weren't exactly touted as a top favorite to even get there. They still had remnants from their glory days, including team captain Bob Gainey and all-star defenseman Larry Robinson, at the age of 35, was playing some of his best hockey at this point. They also had stars such as Matt Snazlin up front and veteran Bobby Smith to boot. The team was mostly made up of rookies and young players, as they too had a rookie goalie in net, Patrick Waugh. Game 1 took place in Calgary, and the Flames were ready to go. The Flames had just finished 2 points ahead of Montreal in the regular season, however. It was going to be a pretty evenly matched. While the Habs drew first blood, the Flames went up 2-1 to end the first period. Neither team could get a goal in the second, but the Flames scorched the Habs. Yes, that also was an intentional pun. And led 4-1 after Lanny scored his first finals goal ever. The Flames went on to take Game 1, 5-2. The Flames looked fantastic again in Game 2 as 15 seconds into the second period, Lanny set up Reinhardt on the power play to have the Flames take a 2-0 lead in the game. The Habs, however, and their group of rookies came together and ended up tying the game by early in the third period. And later on, we're up to overtime, and never mind, Brian Skrudlin scores for the Habs about 9 seconds in, setting an NHL record for fastest overtime goal ever, and we're off to Montreal for the next two games with the series tied. In Game 3, Mullen strikes first, but just over a minute later, Naslin ties it for the Habs. The end of the first period, however, is chaotic. Gelato scores to give the Flames a lead back. But 26 seconds later, Bobby Smith scores. 52 seconds later, Naslin again. 60 seconds later, Gainey. And just like that, the Habs are up 4-2. Four goals in the span of 1:34, and the three by the Habs in just 1:08. Lanny is working his mustache off to get the Flames back in this thing, and it pays off. He scores a power play marker, his 11th goal of the playoffs. The Flames trail by a goal, but with 38 seconds left in the period, Jell Dallin scores for the Habs, and their defense and rookie goalie hold the Flames off. The Habs now have a 2-1 series lead in a game that saw over 100 penalty minutes. In Game 4, the Habs defense shuts them down again, as Waugh stops all 15 shots he faces in a 1-0 win on a lone goal by the Habs' best clutcher of these playoffs, rookie Claude Lemieux. It was a game that also ended in a bench-clearing brawl. The Flames' dream season was one game away from ending as the series was back to Calgary. Flames fans, however, are ready and they feel their team can stay alive. The Flames work tirelessly and Lanny is showing his will to win with every shift he plays, but Waugh is just too good a net, and the Flames find themselves down 4-1 halfway in the third period. But with 3:14 left, Steve Bozak scores to cut the lead down to 2, and the building erupts when Joe Mullen scores with 46 seconds to play. It's 4-3 Montreal. The Flames are fighting so hard to stay alive. The Flames have another huge chance, but this time, Waugh is ready for it. The seconds tick down 3-2-1, and the Flames season ends in defeat. Lanny's dream has to wait another year as Montreal raises the cup. Lanny was shut down after Game 2 as the Habs' defensive prowess helped contain a lot of top Flames forwards in the series. Lanny was just outside the top 5 in playoff scoring with 11 goals and 7 assists for 18 points, but his 11 goals were only second behind teammate Joe Mullen in the lead in the entire playoffs. And in terms of who he clicked with most this season, however, it was no surprise Dan Quinn, who has evolved while working with Lanny throughout his young career, is the man Lanny clicked with on every category across the board. They collaborated one way or another with 31 goals. Lanny's stride to win it all is what makes this season so special. After missing a combined 52 games in the previous two seasons, he didn't miss a single one this year, including the playoffs. He helped guide his team all the way to the big dance even if they couldn't win it. Lanny was second also in team scoring and was among the top 10 in playoff scores and was second in goals during the postseason. He played his first Stanley Cup final to boot. Lanny nearly had a taste of the biggest success he has craved his whole career. Now, the hunger grew even further. Now going into the 1986-87 season, Lanny still had the Stanley Cup in his sights, but he also had some personal milestones. At this point in his career, he had 939 points, meaning he was 61 away from the coveted 1,000-point mark, which at that point had only been achieved by 20 players in NHL history, including Lanny's former teammate, Darryl Sittler, who had retired in 1985. Lanny was also at 465 goals, 35 away from 500, and achieved by 13 players at that time. And on top of that, he was closing in on 1,000 career games. He had played 942. There was no doubt in the minds of many fans that he could reach at least two, if not all three, of these milestones in one season. In the first game of the season, he was well on his way as he scored 2 goals in a win against the Boston Bruins on the road. But the buzz went away pretty quick. The Flames started the month of October 3-7-0, and Lanny played in all 10 games and had 6 points. The Flames, however, started a winning streak once November began that totaled 5 wins and would go on to win 8 of their next 9 games. But just 3 games into November, however, Lanny was hurt as knee injuries were plaguing him. He had missed nearly a month of action, totaling 12 games. And when Lanny returned, the Flames were looking like a great team at 14-11-1. In his absence, they traded Dan Quinn, the man he had built such great chemistry with over the last few seasons. The man they got in return was Mike Bullard, a consistent 30-plus goal scorer from Pittsburgh who had reached the 50-goal mark once and reached 40 the previous season. After Lanny's return, however, the Flames were playing well, but just 4 games back, he'd missed another 6. And going to New Year's Eve game against the Detroit Red Wings, Lanny was on an 8-game pointless streak dating back to before his first injury even. Some say it was because his injuries were lingering, some say it was because Dan Quinn was gone. Others say it's because of limited ice time, but whatever the reason, be it one combination or any one of them, Lanny found himself in the biggest drought he'd been in since his sophomore year, but he broke it in the goal in the game against the Red Wings. but the Flames would lose. Lanny would then go on another six-game pointless drought. He'd then miss four more games in February, but upon his return after that stretch, he'd only miss one more as a whole. Be that as it may, he played 58 games, and he had career lows across the board of 14 goals, tying a career low from his rookie year, adding 12 assists for a total of 26 points. Career lows as well. Despite this, however, Lanny did achieve one of those personal milestones he set out to get that year. In the final regular season game of the season, in a home game against the Winnipeg Jets, Lanny received a standing ovation from adoring fans in Calgary who held him in the highest regard as he played his 1,000th career NHL game. Lanny was still out there doing everything he could despite the setbacks. He still played with all his heart, but it looked like Father Time was catching up. Lanny was 34 years old. In life, he's still a young man, but in the world of pro hockey, that means the clock is winding down even further. Lanny also achieved something else big that year. He became a best-selling author! Yes, during the season, an autobiography he wrote alongside famed sports writer Steve Simmons was released, simply titled Lanny. It became a huge surprise hit across Canada and made the bestsellers list and received critical acclaim to boot. If you can find a copy, I highly recommend it as well. Even though Lanny's overall story wasn't quite over at this point. The Flames had a great year with a record of 46-31-3 for 95 points, the best season in Flames history. Second place again, but this time only 11 points behind a more humbled Oilers squad. Awaiting the Flames in the first round were the Winnipeg Jets for the third straight season. The Jets had improved in the prior season to boot, reaching 40 wins and 88 points. Game 1 took place in Calgary, and while Mike Vernon had become part of the full-time roster, he and Reggie Lemelin shared goaltending duties, and Lemelin started the first game. While the Flames did have a 2-1 lead, they ended up losing 4-2 thanks to a solid game from the Jets' defense. In Game 2, Vernon got the call on net and all goals this game, which saw 76 combined penalty minutes, that is, were scored in the second period. Bullard struck first to give the Flames the lead, but then Dale Hawerchuk set up Paul McLean on 2 goals. The Jets took a 2-1 lead. Bullard scored a second of the game to tie it, but with literally a second left in the frame, Thomas Steen scored. The Jets led 3-2. Their young goalie Daniel Berthaume played great, and the Jets shocked the Flames by taking both games in Calgary, and it didn't look good either in Game 3, as back in Winnipeg, as the Jets took a 2-0 lead in the first period, but Bozek and Mullen tied it 2-2 after one. Next two periods, however, Vernon and Berthaume held their opposition off the score sheet. In overtime, however, Mike Bullard scores just under 4 minutes in and gives the Flames a much-needed win. Game 4 is intense, and Lanny misses this one, however. 124 combined penalty minutes, and the Flames lead 2-0, but win way through the second, the Jets get on the board. And 5 minutes later, they tie it. The Jets take a 4-2 lead in the third period, and the Flames get one back, but lose 4-3 on the verge of elimination going back home. Lanny returns for Game 5, and the Flames are up against the wall. They lead 3-1 in the second, but McLean and Hawerchuk each strike with goals. It's 3-3 after two. In the third period, Joe Mullen, who has struggled a bit, the series scores, and Vernon holds them in, and the Flames force a sixth game and still alive headed to Winnipeg. The Flames season, however, comes to a humiliating end, and they get dominated 6-1 after Vernon let in 4 first-period goals. He was out of the game, and that was it for Calgary's season. Lanny's woes on the score sheet continued, and despite his work ethic not changing, you could see how the injuries had affected him and what he'd gone through all season. Lanny again didn't have much going on the score sheet all season, but what he did score was thanks in large part to John Tinelli and Steve Bozek when it came to his goals. A third of his 12 assists were to the man who replaced his linemate Dan Quinn, Mike Bullard, while he collaborated with Al MacInnis as well for a quarter of those assists to boot. While he did achieve his 1,000th game and became a best-selling author, his scoring production drop and injuries, plus losing in the first round of the playoffs, had to be tough. And it's likely a year Lanny may want to forget with career lows across the board. The Flames made more changes in the offseason heading into the 1987-88 season, the biggest being the departure of Badger Bob Johnson after he coached the team for 5 seasons. He moved on to work for the U.S. National Team office. The new man they hired was Terry Crisp, a former centerman who played 536 NHL games and won 2 Stanley Cups as a member of the Philadelphia Flyers in the 70s. After he retired, he spent 2 years as an assistant coach in Philly and had a successful 6-season tenure as the coach of the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds of the Ontario Hockey League, obtaining a championship in the process. He then moved on for 2 seasons to coach the Moncton Golden Flames, the AHL Farm Club affiliate of Calgary, who had an impressive young winger named Brett Hull. The other change was that Reggie Lemelin had gone to Boston and Mike Vernon was the team's official starting goaltender. Also, rookies such as youngster Joe Nieuwendyk had joined the team, as did this Brett Hull kid himself. They also acquired veteran defenseman Brad McCrimmon, who was grossly underrated and was coming off two Stanley Cup appearances in three seasons with the Flyers. Lanny, however, still had several people concerned about his health going into the 1987-88 season. In the first 19 games of the season, Lanny stayed healthy but only had 2 points. He had missed 5 games after that but would return with a 2-point night against the Kings. Lanny's scoring touch may have dwindled, but it was very clear he was still important to this club. His leadership and work ethic are also very much welcome, even if the scoring is not there. He was playing through pain on many nights, however, as many people didn't know, and would miss more games as the season progressed. It had even come to the point where on some nights he was a healthy scratch on the lineup. The Flames, though, were doing incredible as a whole, and on their way to their best season ever. Lanny had 10 goals, 13 assists for 23 points, setting career lows again for goals and points. Hey, don't at me, I'm not criticizing him, I'm just simply pointing out facts. Lanny would miss 20 games, but the Flames would finish 48-23-9 for 105 points, their first 100-point season ever, and they had the best record in the league, which meant they won the President's Trophy. But anyway, there was some good news for Lanny, as he was awarded the King Clancy Memorial Trophy for his humanitarian and charity work both in Calgary and Toronto. Being first in the Smythe division had to be huge as well after being second to Edmonton for so long. They were 6 points over the Oilers, who had won back the cup the year prior. However, the Flames, towards the end of the season, traded Brett Hull. Yes, they traded Brett Hull in order to obtain veteran defenseman Rob Ramage. And hey, no disrespect to Rob, he was quite good in his time. But they traded Brett Hull. Anyway, awaiting them in the playoffs were the Los Angeles Kings. A growing team that had a losing record, however, but still had great talents such as young sophomores Jimmy Karsten and Luke Robitaille, who both had over 100 points. Also defenseman Steve Duchene, plus star center Bernie Nichols and veteran all-star Dave Taylor. Lanny could likely almost taste the cup, however, and game one from Calgary was a doozy, kicked off by Lanny scoring the opening goal en route to a monster 9-2 win, a big night from Håkan Lubb, Al MacInnis, and Gary Suter. Game two, the Kings put up a bit more of a fight, but it's not nearly enough. The Flames win 6-4 and have a two-game series lead going to LA as Suter again plays huge. In game three, however, the Kings do have even more fight in them. In a game that had 156 total penalty minutes, Bernie Nichols had a 4-point night. The Kings win 5-2. The Flames get a huge boost as Mike Bullard returns the lineup after injury, missing the first 3 games, although it's Håkan Lubb who steals the show with a hat trick, and the Flames win 7-3 as Lanny has a goal in this one. In game five, in Calgary, it's tied 2-2 in the second, but Paul Reinhart scores, and the Flames don't look back. It's a 6-4 win. Lou plays great again, and the Flames take the series in five. Lanny had 2 goals in the series and was a +3, and was out there like every shift was his last. He wanted the cup, and he wanted it bad. The city of Calgary had great success at the Olympics just a few months prior to this, and what a coup it would be for them to get the Stanley Cup in the same year. But we now brace ourselves for the Battle of Alberta, Part 4. The Oilers, for the first time since the 1980-81 season, missed the 100-point mark, but just barely, with 99 points. They had lost superstar defenseman Paul Coffey of Pittsburgh, and even Wayne Gretzky missed 16 games that year, yet still came in second in league scoring. This would, however, test Terry Cripps' abilities as a coach. For reasons that make sense to literally almost nobody, John Tinelli was benched for Game 1. He played well in the LA series, and come on, he's the most experienced guy on your team when it comes to the playoffs. In 7 seasons, he played in 6 finals at one point. Anyway. Many thought, however, this would truly be Calgary's time to reach the top. But in Game 1, Grant Fear was amazing in net, and Messier struck first for Edmonton, but just over 2 minutes later, McCrimmon tied it. Mike Vernon didn't play well, neither did the rest of the team, really. The second period was scoreless, but Curry and Gretzky made easy work of Vernon. With a goal each in the third, the Oilers took Game 1 3-1. Thankfully, Terry Crisp grew a brain and dressed John Tinelli for Game 2, and Lanny opens the scoring and we're off and running. The game was a tense 90-total penalty minute fest. The Flames would take a 2-0 lead as MacInnis scored, but Messier added one to close the gap. The Flames, however, retook their 2-goal lead in the second thanks to Rob Ramage, with just under 2 minutes apart, Charlie Huddy and Wayne Gretzky scored. The game is tied 3-3. Tim Hunter scored early in the third to give the Flames their lead back, but with 3:59 to go, Yari Curry scored and this game is headed to overtime. Mark Messier took a costly penalty, however, and this would be where the Flames had to strike. They had the best power play in the NHL all season. However, as the penalty was winding down, Curry sends Gretzky in all alone, who launches a beautiful shot past Vernon. A huge heartbreaker for the Flames. They drop 2 games at home, and the fans are silenced. The Flames head to Edmonton to try to shake things up, and again, Crisp scratches Tinelli from the lineup. Despite a great shorthanded goal from Hockenlund, the Flames looked just broken as a bunch. The Oilers had a 3-1 lead after two periods, and while Nieuwendyk got one back, it didn't make a difference. The Oilers would win 4-2 and were on the verge of a sweep. Lanny was still playing his heart out in Game 4, but it mattered very little. The Oilers went up 4-0, and while Calgary made it 4-2 at one point, they'd lose 6-4. And guess who got the final goal of the season for the Flames? No, not Lanny, but John Tonelli. The Flames are embarrassed and swept out after their best season ever. And yes, the Oilers went on to win the Cup. Lanny's playoff heartbreak continues and time is running out. His injuries are mounting, and the team is actually starting to really disconnect from Coach Terry Crisp. They're definitely missing the ways of the Badger. Lanny mostly played alongside Grinders while occasionally shifting with top forwards. He worked well, however, with Steve Bosak and Tim Hunter most of the year. Lanny's season ends again in heartbreak. The injuries mount up, and while he plays well in the playoffs, he's getting scratched sometimes in the lineup during the regular season. The bright spot is that he's recognized for all the great humanitarian and charity volunteer work he does in his spare time by being awarded the King Clancy Memorial Trophy. As the 1988-89 season approached, the wear and tear on Lanny's body was evident. He was about to enter his 16th season, while his leadership was still valued by his teammates. They were just wondering how much further he could go. The controversy regarding John Tonelli during the playoffs led to him leaving the Flames and signing with the LA Kings. Mike Bullard, who particularly disappeared in the playoffs, was traded to the St. Louis Blues in exchange for Doug Gilmore. Also, Paul Reinhardt departed the team for the Vancouver Canucks. But the Flames still looked dangerous going into the season, and Lanny full well knew this could be his last chance. Lanny battled more injuries and was scratched in the lineup often, to the point where he missed 29 games playing in just 51. But the team was dominating everyone in the league. The Flames didn't let what happened to them last season break, and every game Lanny played, he made the most of it. He was still happy to be a part of the team, and the young players looked up to their veteran leader, as Lanny was still taking his role as the captain very seriously. On March 7, 1989, in a home game against the Winnipeg Jets, just 2:46 into the game, Lanny scored a wraparound effort that found its way into the net, scoring on Bob Esenza of the Jets, and where he became the 23rd player in NHL history to reach 1,000 career points. Lanny added another goal in the 9-5 win. 2 weeks later at home against the New York Islanders on March 21, 1989, in a very similar fashion, scored on Mark Fitzpatrick of the New York Islanders, and it would be the final regular season goal of Lanny's career. It was also his 500th. He had 11 goals and 7 assists for 18 points in this season in 51 games, and he reached his 1,000th point and 500th goal, but now he had one more goal to accomplish. But the question remained, however, just how much playing time would Lanny even see in these playoffs, as despite Terry Crisp's rocky relationship with his players and questionable coaching decisions, it didn't seem at a spite or anything that Lanny was being set out some games, but he was still revered by his teammates, and the fans and the whole community, it seemed, just wanted him in there. They know that this is maybe his last chance as well. They wanted him to win that cup. There were signs in crowds reading, "Lanny needs a ring," often shown throughout the season. The Olympic Saddledome fans wanted to see their hero get what he so well deserved. But not just deserved, they knew he'd fight for it to boot. The Flames finished 54-17-9. 117 points. Best in the league again, winning that President's Trophy. Again, their best season ever. In the first round, the Flames would meet the Vancouver Canucks, an upstart losing team record, however. Their first playoff appearance in 3 years. They still had longtime stars like Tony Tanney and Stan Schmeal. Youngsters such as first-round draft pick, however, Trevor Linden and Brian Bradley, and their goaltender Kirk McLean were the ones making waves that season. Game 1 takes place from Calgary, and Lanny is scratched in the lineup. The first period ends tied 1-1. Mullen gives the Flames the lead on the power play, but the Canucks tie it, and however, McCowan gives the Flames a 3-2 lead after 2. The Canucks score the only goal of the third period from Petr Skriko, and neither team has an answer, and we're off to overtime, but just 2:47 in, former Flame Paul Reinhardt strikes the dagger in, and Vancouver shockingly takes Game 1. In Game 2, despite a combined 86 penalty minutes on both sides, the Flames are more focused and determined. They have a 4-0 lead and don't look back on route to a 5-2 win. The series shifts to Vancouver, and Mike Vernon stops literally everything that's shot at him. Big night for Hockenlund, Joe Nieuwendyk, and Gary Roberts as the Flames blank the Canucks 4-0 and take a 2-1 series lead. Well, Lanny finally sets up for his first game of the playoffs in Game 4, taking place in Vancouver, but the Canucks are red hot and have signed backup Steve Weiss as the star in net en route to a 5-2 Canucks victory in a big 4-point night for rookie sensation Trevor Linden. What is happening here now? Are the Flames going to blow it again? The series is tied 2-2 heading to Calgary. Again, Lanny is scratched from the lineup, but the Flames' defense takes care of the Canucks, and they barely can get anything on Vernon. But when he does, he stops it all. 4-0 win for the Flames, going back to Vancouver for Game 6 and a chance to win this series. But it's not to be. Kirk McLean is superb in net for the Canucks, and Vernon can't stop a beach ball on this night, however. And the Canucks take it 6-3. We're going to Game 7. Yep, the critics are out again. Same old Flames, yada, 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 yada. But for this important game, Crisp activates Lanny for the lineup, and we're off to an epic Game 7. I've watched this game many times. I can honestly say it's one of my favorite games to watch this stage. Truly a superb playoff hockey classic took place this night. Emotions, tension, passion for the game, it was all there. Every time Lanny stepped on the ice, he was hustling as hard as he could to make any difference possible. Both teams exchanged power play goals in the first period, but Gary Roberts gives the Flames the lead to end the first period 2-1. Trevor Linden ties it in the second, but with 35 seconds left in the frame, Joe Mullen gives the Flames a 3-2 lead after 40 minutes. The only goal in the third period is scored by Doug Lister of the Canucks, and we're tied up at 3. I should note that Vernon and McLean are making epic saves in net, then which leads us to overtime. Chance after chance, after chance after chance, with the fans on the edge of their seat, Mike Vernon making nearly impossible saves, people gasping for air in suspense. Kirk McLean also stopping everything in his path to boot, as Flames fans falsely cheer, thinking they had won the game. Lanny out there doing everything in his power to help his team win. The overtime period, however, was winding down, and Lube took the puck, carrying it in. He passed it to Poplinski, shot it in through traffic. It deflects off Giolotto. He scores! The Flames avoid the upset with the thrill ride of a win in Game 7 to take it. Terry Crisp looks more relieved than happy, as Lanny's dream is still alive as well. Lanny only played 2 games in the series, but again led by example with the way he was out there. If Lanny's tank was going to be on empty by the time these playoffs were over, he was going to use out every last bit of fuel to make it count. Awaiting the Flames in the next round were the LA Kings. This was the same team that faced them last year. This team had 42 wins in a 91-point season, and yes, they now had Wayne Gretzky to boot. Terry Crisp decided Lanny should be in this series, however, and suits him up for Game 1. It's a back-and-forth game, and the Flames find themselves down 3-2 late in the third period. With 1:36 left, Gary Roberts scores a tie-in, and we're off to another overtime period. This time, just 7:47 in, Doug Gilmore scores, and the Flames take Game 1. Game 2 would have over 130 penalty minutes, and the Flames did some damage in a huge way in a dominant 8-3 win. Mullen and Gilmore are the stars tonight, and Lanny beautifully set up one of Gilmore's goals for his first point of the playoffs. This series shifts to LA, and the Flames just can't be stopped. 5-2 win, another big game from Gilmore, and a huge night for Lanny with 2 assists. He's a +2 to boot. The Flames are on the verge of sweeping the series. And yes, that's just what happened. In Game 4, a 5-3 win, the Calgary Flames are back in the conference finals. Lanny played every game of the series and was truly playing like the hero Flames fans viewed him as. 3 assists in the entire series and hustling like there's no tomorrow. In the conference finals, however, the Flames would face an upstart club who only won 27 games all year, yet had been making a miracle run through these playoffs, the Chicago Blackhawks. They did have their fair share of talent, with Denny Savard, Steve Larmer, and Doug Wilson primarily being the stars of that club. The Flames were heavy favorites, but keeping in mind how the Canucks took them to the limit, they weren't taking the Blackhawks lightly. In Game 1, the Flames' defense stood tall, as Vernon stopped anything and everything that was thrown at him, and the Flames take it 3-0. However, in Game 2, the Blackhawks take Vernon and the Flames' defense apart and shocked them with a 4-2 win. The series is tied, heading back to the Windy City. Game 3, Gilmore, Mullen, and McInnes go to work. The Blackhawks left reeling and drop a 5-2 loss. The story of Game 4, however, is excellent goaltending from Alain Chevrier of the Hawks, and the Flames' defense making it difficult for Chicago forwards. Savard and Gilmore each scored power play goals in the second, and that was all it was by the end of regulation. Another thrilling overtime game, and just over 50 minutes in, Al McInnes scores, and the Flames are heading back home just one win away from returning to the Cup. In Game 5, the Flames absolutely bombarded Chevrier, and while he made some great stops, I will say, it's tied 1-1 in the third period as he keeps Chicago in the game, but Brian McClellan scores just over 5 minutes in to get the Flames a 2-1 lead, and with just over 3 minutes to go in the game, Joe Nieuwendyk scores. The Flames are 3-1 and the clock runs down, and Calgary is going back to the Stanley Cup. Lanny plays in all 5 games of the series, but he did not register a point. Be it as it may, however, he was out there keeping his dream alive. He now had what he worked for, and that's one more shot at the Holy Grail. But awaiting the Flames, the same team from the 3 years prior. the Montreal Canadiens. Only this time, nobody was surprised they were there either. The Habs only finished 2 points behind Calgary and were the second best team in the league. This was going to be one hell of a series. Lanny was confident and ready as Game 1 took place from the Centrodome. It was a highly competitive affair. The Habs and the Flames were as evenly matched as you could get. Both Patrick Waugh and Mike Vernon have progressed from the upstart rookies to being among the best in the league. And they were playing like it in this game. The Habs, however, struck first, not even 3 minutes in on a power play goal by Stefan Richie. But not long after, Al McInnes scores not one, but two goals. Less than 2 minutes apart, the Flames lead 2-1. However, a minute and a half later, 17-year vet and future Hall of Famer Larry Robinson ties it. But in the second period, young rookie Theo Fleury gives the Flames the lead. Vernon is a stalwart the rest of the way through, and the Flames cling on to this lead and hold it all the way through to take Game 1. Game 2 sees the Habs take a 2-0 lead early in the second period, but Otto and Neuendijk tie it. It's 2-2 after 2. Chris Chelios of the Montreal Canadiens, their star defenseman, had a big night. He scores in the third period, and a minute and a half later, the Habs add another and take a 4-2 win. The series is tied, heading to Montreal. Lanny, however, is scratched in the lineup for Game 3, and what a game it was. Tied 1-1 in the second period when Mullen gives the Flames the lead. In the third period, Bobby Smith ties up for the Habs, but Gilmore takes the lead back for Calgary. It looks like Calgary is going to take it, but 41 seconds left, Habs star forward Mats Naslund scores. We're off to overtime. However, the defense on both sides is excellent, and the goalies are making big saves when they need to. The first overtime expires with no end. We're off to double overtime, and even while that one's starting to wind down, which is under 2 minutes to play in the overtime period, Ryan Walter wins it for the Habs. They take a 2-1 series lead. For Game 4, however, the Flames' defense is outstanding while Waugh is bombarded. And in the second period, the Flames take a 2-0 lead courtesy of Gilmore and Mullen. Russ Cordell gets Montreal on the board in the third, but this sets up a thrilling finish. With 1:38 to go, McInnes scores, and the Flames have a 2-goal lead in the game in hand. But wait, Claude Lemieux comes up with the clutch with 27 seconds left. Can the Habs pull off a miracle? Well, that would be a no. Mullen scores again, this time an empty netter, and the series is tied 2-2 heading to Calgary. Lanny, however, hasn't suited up since Game 2, and he's not asked for Game 5 either at the Centrodome, as Joel Otto scores 28 seconds in, and Mullen scores later, and the Habs are playing catch-up the rest of the way. They almost get there, but Vernon holds them off. The Flames take this game 3-2 and the series, and they are one win away from the first Stanley Cup. For Game 6, Coach Terry Crisp had a decision to make. This was the biggest game in Flames history, and Lanny had waited 16 years for this moment, and he wants to be there to make it happen. Crisp makes a decision. Lanny will play in Game 6 and wear the captaincy on his jersey. The Flames look to end this tonight, while the Habs look to force a Game 7. Lanny looks ready and so do the rest of the Flames. Both teams' defenses are holding them in the game early on. Lanny is playing with all the strength he can muster and has left with every shift, and looks like a commanding soldier out there. The Flames strike as the first period is winding down. Colin Patterson makes it 1-0 at the end of the first period. Just over a minute into the second period, Claude Lemieux scores for Montreal. It's tied at 1, and not long after, Lanny is sent to the penalty box on a holding call. The Flames kill the penalty, however, and not long after that, Lanny leaves the box. He joins in Lube and Neuendijk, and then it happened. Lanny scores! The jubilation on his face says it all. A man who has scored many key and important goals scores perhaps the most important, no, scratch that, scores the most important goal of his career. A glorious moment frozen in time. Lanny's goal gives the Flames a 2-1 lead, which they'd hold on to in the second intermission. In the third period, Gilmore scores on the power play, but the Habs score 51 seconds later to stay in it. Both teams are fighting. Lanny is still out there as well, trying to keep things going, and with 1:03 left, Gilmore adds an empty netter. It's 4-2 Flames. The clock ticks down. 16 years ticks down. 3, 2, 1. The Calgary Flames are Stanley Cup champions. Lanny will get to wear the ring he's longed to have for so long. The cup, of course, first goes to the captain. And Lanny wearing the C graciously accepts it with a smile that you can see through that trademark mustache. Along with his co-captain Jim Poplitsky and alternate captain Tim Hunter, Lanny takes the victory lap. As he proudly hoists the very thing he wanted more than anything in his entire career. He was lifting 16 seasons of ups, downs, epic moments, many goals, many achievements, turmoil, hardship, and glory over his head. Lanny can call himself a champion. Lanny may have had that epic moment, but he didn't become a champion by scoring. He provided the Flames with guidance, leadership, and the never-say-die attitude that he was known for. That's who he was through and through. Lanny's final year saw him score 18 points, 11 goals, and 7 assists, and work a lot with young rookie Theo Fleury. Also saw him work a lot with those grinding lines as well, including Joel Otto. Lanny achieved his 1,000th career point and 500th goal just 2 weeks apart. This big year ended with him captaining his team all the way to the Stanley Cup and scoring the most important goal of his career to help make it happen. Lanny had achieved everything he had ever wanted. Indeed, just about 3 months later, Lanny announced his retirement from the game of hockey. His time with the Flames is memorable not just for his accomplishments, but for how he ingrained himself into the city of Calgary and its culture and became a local celebrity, pretty much because the people made it that way. To this very day, he is revered as an icon. Accomplishing a great deal, he left the game with no regrets. His 8 amazing seasons in Calgary truly etched his legacy in the annals of hockey history and made him into a bona fide megastar. Since his retirement, however, Lanny has done anything but leave the game behind. Right after his retirement, he remained with the Flames organization under several different roles, on and off, for many years to this very day. At times, however, his relationship with the team has been a little rocky, but always finds its way back. He was also director of player personnel for Team Canada's 2004 gold medal win at the World Hockey Championships. He remains very active in the Calgary community and is still a local celebrity in the city, while still contributing to many charities. However, he never harbored any ill will towards Toronto or the Leafs organization and has taken part in several alumni events for the team over the years to boot. And after Denver got a new hockey team in 1985, who we all now know as the Colorado Avalanche, he has even made appearances down that way as well, showing that everywhere he played mattered to him. Lanny, to no surprise in his first year of eligibility, was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame in 1992. His number 9 has been retired as well by the Calgary Flames. What a career. 16 incredible seasons. A master of the puck. A tremendous leader. Respected by his teammates. A never-quit attitude. The will to win. And just an all-around great guy. That does it for our look at the great career of Lanny McDonald. What other players' careers would you like to see me cover? Leave a comment below to let me know. And also, hit like on this video and hit subscribe. Until next time, I'll see ya. This video series about Lanny McDonald is dedicated to the memory of one of Lanny's biggest fans, my grandmother, Helen Tower.